You turn mourning to dancing. You give beauty for ashes. You turn shame into glory. You're the only one who cares. You turn
Well, good morning. Lovely day. It's a great day to be in the house of the Lord. I know that much. You know what? That song is so true. There's nothing better than Jesus. Nothing. You can have riches. You can have all the things that you want. But there's nothing better than to have a relationship with the Lord Jesus Christ. Amen. Wonderful. Wonderful. Well, it's good to see you all, and for those that are here new this morning, we welcome you and ask God's blessing on you and that He'd lead, guide, and direct you in all things. Is that right? And that's good, isn't it? So I want to pray this morning for Karina's daughter. She's out in out in British Columbia, and she's pregnant, and they didn't know if she was going into labor, but she's only 6 months. So we have a God that can touch situations, whether they're in British Columbia or whether they're here in the Miramichi or wherever they are. We join in the Spirit and we ask God to touch Kayla this morning and heal her. And Karina's husband, Keith, needs a touch from the Lord. And everybody else, we just pray and believe. I need a little touch in my leg, but you know what? God is able. We just got to believe. So we welcome you, Holy Spirit, this morning into the house. There's miracles, Father God, that we need today across Canada. This virus going around, all the confusion. We know one thing. the Bible says that you're not a God of confusion. So our hope and our prayer and our life is in you. God, we just pray for our people, no matter where they are. We just pray, God, that you will touch them and heal them in the name of Jesus. We pray for our worship team this morning, that the anointing of God would be upon them. Pastor John is
Hosanna, Hosanna. welcome you to the house of the Lord this morning. Thank you, Lord. I can feel the presence of the Lord in here. Very strong. He knows there's people opening up their hearts, opening up their lives to Him. Just listen to the words of the song. Let it soak in. Thank you, Jesus.
His love is so deep. Praise the Lord.
Hallelujah.
Can you hear me now? Thank you, Lord. We can get it. There's lots of mics here, but this one don't work.
It's good to see you all here today. Can you hear me? Can you hear me at the back? There's still seats at the front. Something is going on with your seven sister. Maybe I'm talking this one.
Praise the Lord. I could talk in that.
Well, he's getting this one ready. Praise the Lord. This one isn't working,
but this one is. Hallelujah.
Praise the Lord. No, not yet.
Testing. You know, I had a special thing happen this week. And you might not think it was very big, but I do. And my cat got sick. And you know, that's not a very nice thing, is it? And I asked God. God spoke to me, and he said, "I see a sparrow if it falls." Whoops. And so I prayed for my cat. And I said, "God, if you heal my cat, I'll thank you for it." And he healed my cat. Should see him going today. Praise the Lord. So if God so clothes the grass of the field, which today is and tomorrow is cast into the oven, how much more will he care for you? Hallelujah. I feel like someone's going to get healed online today. I'm just sitting down there, I just felt in my spirit. I feel a real strong presence of God here. What kind of feelers? I heard Trina saying that earlier. She said, "I feel God here." And, you know, we all kind of look for that, don't we? We're kind of from a breed of people that like to feel our way along and feel God. Hallelujah. And so, boy, that's kind of up and down. I'm going to take the other one. Is that?
Can you just switch, please? Praise the Lord. What's wrong? Trina's mic. Okay.
I'll take Trina. I'll throw that way up in the woods.
Praise the Lord. No, I'm done those days. Praise God. I have a special message for you today, and that's why we get some technical trouble. When we get to heaven, God's going to say to you, "There was a devil in your church. He was called technology." You brought them every week. But boy, you know, we need this technology too. A lot of people getting a lot of help from, praise the Lord. I want to talk to you about a very special thing that God spoke to me about. And if you follow me closely today, God will speak into your heart. And it will be a great thing. In Psalm 75 and verse 4 to 8, he said, "I warned the proud, stop your boasting. I told the wicked, don't raise your fists. Don't raise your fists in defiance at the heavens or speak with such arrogance. For no one on earth, from east or west, or even from the wilderness, should raise a defiant fist. It is God alone who judges. He decides who will rise and who will fall." And this is what I want to talk to you about. For the Lord holds a cup in his hand. We were singing about that this morning. And that wasn't, I hadn't requested that. They were just doing that in the spirit. The Lord holds a cup in his hand that is full of foaming wine mixed with spices. He pours out the wine in judgment, and all the wicked must drink it, draining it to the dregs. Father, help me today. Help me to share this word, O God, the way you would want it shared. We read the Gospel of John, and it said the word became flesh, and we want it to become flesh today. I pray, Lord, that you will touch somebody who's listening online right now, and bring healing to their body. And I pray, Lord, for someone like Willard prayed before, for somebody who needs a touch in British Columbia, touch them right now, Lord. Father, we give ourselves to you. In Jesus' name, amen. If you read the Bible closely, you will find that from the time Joseph, remember the story of Joseph, how he went down to Egypt and his brothers had sold him as a slave there, and he went down to Egypt, and then the boys had a famine in Canaan land, and they had to come down and get grain, and so Joseph filled all their sacks with grain, but he filled Benjamin's, put his cup in it. Remember that? Benjamin was his younger brother. And he put his cup in it, and then when they started back home, he sent some soldiers after them, and they said, "You stole my cup." And they said, "No, no, we didn't steal your cup." "Oh, yeah, you stole Joseph's cup." And they looked in Benjamin's bag, and there it was. And they said, "The guy got to go to jail." And you know the story. And one of the other brothers said, "No, no, 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 we can't do that." And there was a change in their lives. And ever since that, in the Bible, cup and judgment were associated together. David writes here about there is a cup of judgment that people drink, for the judgment of God comes on the people or the nation that drink it. Many of the prophets, as you read through the prophets, they talk about this same cup. Isaiah writes, just before Judah is destroyed in Isaiah 51 and verse 17, he said, "Wake up, wake up, O Jerusalem, you have drunk the cup of the Lord's fury. You have drunk the cup of terror, tipping it out to the last drops." Jeremiah spells out the same story on this cup a lot clearer. He tells the nation exactly what the cup is that they are drinking. In Jeremiah chapter 51 and verse 7, he said, "Babylon has been a gold cup in the Lord's hands." It's quite a thing, isn't it? Babylon has been a gold cup in the Lord's hand, a cup that made the whole earth drunk. The nations drank Babylon's wine, and it drove them all mad. In fact, Jeremiah, if you read those chapters, you find that Jeremiah has a whole list of nations that are going to drink from that gold cup from Babylon, and they're going to face judgment because of it, huge judgment. And if you study a little bit of history, you learn that those nations, Babylon come down, they weren't nice people. They skinned people alive. They did all kinds of really cruel things to the communities that they took over, to the nations they took over. In chapter 25 and verse 27 to 29, he said, "Then the Lord said to me, 'Now tell them, this is what the Lord of heaven's armies, the God of Israel, says, drink from this cup of my anger. Get drunk and vomit. Fall to rise no more, for I am sending terrible wars against you. And if they refuse to accept the cup, tell them, the Lord of heaven's armies says you have no choice but to drink from it. I have begun to punish Jerusalem, the city that bears my name. Now, should I let you go unpunished? No, you will not escape disaster." He's talking to the nations around Israel. And a casual reading of history will tell you that these nations suffered immensely after Jeremiah said that. Over the hundreds of years of talking about this cup, the prophets always were talking about this cup. Over the hundreds of years and watching nations go through its judgment, it was a pretty well-established thing in the mindset of the Jews that God had a cup of judgment for the world when Jesus came along. They knew what that cup meant. It is the anger and judgment and fury of God himself. So one day when Jesus was on earth, I kind of like this story. One day when Jesus was on earth, you know, James and John were nice young men, and they had followed Christ. And their mother came to Jesus one day, and she said, no one else listening. I'll read it for you. It was recorded in Matthew 20 and verse 20 to 22. "Then the mother of James and John, the sons of Zebedee, came to Jesus with her sons. She knelt respectfully to ask a favor. 'What is your request?' he asked. She replied, 'In your kingdom, please, let my two sons sit in places of honor next to you, one on the right and the other on the left.' But Jesus answered by saying to them, You don't know what you're asking. Are you able to drink from the bitter cup of suffering that I am about to drink? Now that cup, if you read the New Testament closely, is a highly discussed thing. Over 30 times in the New Testament, it talks about this cup. And it keeps bringing it up. Matthew, Mark, and Luke all record an event just prior to the crucifixion. They're all sitting in the room, enjoying a Passover meal, or what used to be a Passover meal that is kind of going to get shifted a little bit during this meal. They are enjoying a Passover meal together when something real unique happens. Matthew records it this way. In Matthew 26 and verse 27, it says this of Jesus. And he took a cup of wine and gave thanks to God for it. I want to ask you something this morning. Was this the cup that David had mentioned in the Psalms, the cup that is in the Lord's hands? You know, I read through Passover back in Exodus, and there was no cup in it. When Moses gave the instructions for Passover meal, there was no cup of wine. Now, by this time, there was perhaps two cups they were drinking from. The Jews have four now. But during this time, there was a couple of cups. So Jesus is sitting there, and he stands up, and he took the cup of wine. The Bible says he gave thanks for it. Was this the cup that was in the Lord's hands? Was this the cup that Isaiah and Jeremiah had written about and watched nations destroyed as they drank it? Was this the cup that Jesus had told the mother of James and John that he had to drink? I'm fascinated as I read this story. Jesus knows what's coming. He has told his disciples on more than one occasion that he is on his way to Jerusalem where he will be crucified. He knows what's coming. In Matthew chapter 20 and verse 18, he said, "Behold, we go up to Jerusalem. The Son of Man shall be betrayed unto the chief priests and scribes, and they will condemn him to death." So Jesus knew what was about to happen. He knows that all the jealousy of the religious world and all the hostility of the pagan world is about to be poured out on him. But he knows more than that. He knows that he is walking in the footsteps that God has laid down for him. Isaiah in Isaiah 53 and verse 6 said, "Yet the Lord laid on him all of our sin, the sins of all of us." What was in that cup that Jesus raised that day at that Passover meal? I'll tell you what was in that cup. Lying and stealing and sexual abuse and shame. And the shame of the sexual abuser and the shame of the one who was abused, betrayal and hurt, deceit, and loss of friendship. Jesus said, "You're all going to betray me tonight." You know what was in that cup? Everything that humanity would ever have to face. Every evil thing, every wicked thing, every shameful thing, every hurtful thing that everybody had ever lived on planet Earth was in that cup. The judgment for the sin of the world was now in the hands of the one who was about to drink it. But Matthew records what he did. He took the cup of wine that all the prophets had trembled at, and when he had given thanks, imagine giving thanks for this cup. Here is, as he called himself the Son of Man, holding the cup of judgment of God for planet Earth in his hands, and he's given thanks. He's giving thanks. And when he gives thanks, something fantastic, something awesome, something wonderful happens. Luke records it this way. In Luke chapter 22 and verse 20, he said, after supper, he took the cup of wine and said, this cup is a new covenant in my blood that is shed for many for the remission of sins, which is poured out as a sacrifice for you. He took that cup of judgment on the world, and when he gave thanks for it, he turned it into a new cup, a cup of covenant that you and I could come into relationship with God Almighty in. Hallelujah. The cup of the Lord's anger, the cup of the Lord's wrath, the cup of the Lord's judgment just became the cup of a covenant of blessing. Hallelujah. And a cup of unmeasurable love. Thank you, Jesus. In that room that night, something big happened. If you read the story of Calvary close, and that's what we're doing as we go through the Lenten season, we're walking in the steps of Jesus. God turned his angry face away from the world that night and away from his Son. That face that had looked in judgment at the world for so long, that caused the earth even to bring forth thistles and thorns, was now looking away. Over the next few hours, Jesus will literally go through hell. And I don't say that disrespectfully. Jesus Christ will actually go through hell itself over the next few hours. What was his prayer in the Garden of Gethsemane? Three times in the Garden of Gethsemane, Jesus falls on his face to the ground. And the first prayer is, Lord, if it is possible, let this cup pass from me. Nevertheless, not my will, but your will be done. Matthew 26 and verse 42, sweating drops of blood, Matthew records Jesus saying, and Jesus left them a second time and prayed, my Father, if this cup cannot be taken away unless I drink it, your will be done. Thank you, Lord. What an amazing night. In only a few hours, the same thorns that were part of the curse will be on his head. Imagine it. From the cross, the Son of Man would cry out in Matthew 27 and verse 46. It's recorded at about the ninth hour. Jesus cried with a loud voice saying, Eli, Eli, lama sabachthani. That is to say, my God, why have you forsaken me? God had turned his head. God had turned his back. God had turned his face from the world that was under the curse and from his own Son that was now under the curse as well, because the Bible said cursed is everyone that hangs on a tree. There he was. It was no small thing to turn that cup of judgment into a covenant, a cup of covenant. But thank God he did it. Jesus took that cup in his hand that was a cup of judgment for the earth, and in his hand giving thanks, and in the Garden of Gethsemane sweating drops of blood, and from the cross saying, my God, why hast thou forsaken me? That cup got turned into a new covenant. Oh my God, that's a wonderful truth. That cup got turned into a cup of blessing. That cup that had judged the earth for so many thousand years was now a whole new cup. Hallelujah. Paul writes about it to the Corinthians who were disrespecting it and saying this in 1 Corinthians 10, verses 15 and 16. I'm talking to intelligent people, he said. Judge for yourself what I'm saying. When we bless, what do you call it? The cup of blessing. When we bless the cup of blessing, aren't we sharing in the blood of Christ? The cup of judgment in the hand of God in the Old Testament has now become a cup of blessing under a new covenant of grace for you and I. When God turned his face from Jesus, the whole world went black. The Bible says that darkness came at midday and covered the earth. It was a terrible day because all of a sudden the sun itself stopped giving light. A world that had been under curse was shaking. The earth, the Bible says on the cross that the earth shook. Something big was happening in the universe. God was changing judgment to grace. Hallelujah. And the cross was taking your sin and my sin and putting it on him. And he bore my judgment and carried the wrath of God and the fury of God. And the grace of God was poured out on me from that day on. Hallelujah. Hallelujah. When those worship leaders stand to sing about the cup, I have to raise my heart to God and say a million times over, this isn't fixing a cat. This is changing a sinful soul that's doomed for hell, setting him free. Hallelujah. This is the cup, the judgment that was poured out on Edom. It was poured out on Moab. It was poured out on the Philistines. It was poured out on Babylon itself ultimately. But now it is offered as a new cup to the world. The darkness at midday at the cross is now turned to radiant glory in the face of Jesus Christ. Paul writes this to the Corinthians in Corinthians chapter 3 and verse 18, 2 Corinthians. So all of us have had that veil removed, can see and reflect the glory of the Lord. When God turned his face on Jesus, and he cried out, my God, why hast thou forsaken me? When he turned his face back, God was smiling at our world. Paul says there is a radiant glory that comes from the face of Jesus Christ because the terrible thing called sin has been destroyed. And the awful curse of death that went with it has been destroyed with it as well. Paul said he tasted death for every man. Hallelujah. If you drink, there's only one thing. I want you to hear me this morning. There is only one thing that turns the cup of judgment into the cup of blessing. And that is the cross of our Lord Jesus Christ. Listen to Paul writing about it. If you drink the cup unworthily, without discerning the Lord's body, the cup becomes judgment again. Listen to it in 1 Corinthians 11, verse 27 and 30. So anyone who eats this bread and drinks this cup of the Lord unworthily is guilty of sinning against the body and blood of the Lord. That is why you should examine yourselves before eating the bread and drinking the cup. For if you eat the bread and drink the cup without honoring, I want to talk to you a little bit about that, without honoring the body of Christ, you are eating and drinking God's judgment upon yourself. I'm going to tell you something this morning. The gathered Christian community, Paul writes to the Corinthians and says, it is the body of Christ on earth. Whenever I lead communion, I always say his body was broken to bring his body together. So Paul says, if you drink and eat, not discerning two things, I think, the body of Christ, which is here on earth, and there in heaven. If you don't take it serious, you're turning the cup of blessing into a cup of judgment. And then he says something. That is why many of you are weak and sick, and some are even dead. So I want to say to you this morning, there is a cup in the Lord's hand today. And what you do with the cross of Jesus Christ will determine if that cup is a cup of blessing or a cup of judgment. Pretty serious thing, isn't it? It's an easy thing in a world that's been covered by grace for 2,000 years to talk always about the love of God and the grace of God. It's the most wonderful thing that ever happened to planet Earth. But that same cup still exists. And it exists as a cup of blessing for the people who take the cross and say, Lord Jesus, forgive me of my sin. I accept you as my Savior and my Lord. But it exists as a cup of judgment for those in a secular world who turn their back on God and say, I don't think so. I think it's all just a fable. And today, as I have spoken about that cup, the Holy Spirit has said to me, this is your moment to open your heart and to receive Jesus Christ as your Savior and enjoy the grace of God and the blessing of God on your life. Or if you say no, our world is starting to shake all over. Our world is starting to go into a new world order, a new day. The day of grace is coming to a close. And I don't say that to put fear in your heart. I say that as reality. We're looking at a world like we have never seen. And still God is bringing people into the ark of safety. And today, sitting right here or listening to me online or wherever you are today, if you will open your heart and receive Jesus as your Savior, you can enjoy his cup of blessing in your life. Let's pray. How many of you sitting here would say, John, I need to be sure that I know Christ is my Savior. I need to be sure. I got a lot of hurt in my life from the past. I got a lot of stuff in my life that I really need help with. I need God's grace in my life today. Anybody would raise your hand and say, John, I need prayer. Please pray for me. God bless you. There are people in this room today who you are Christians, but you've gone through so much hurt in your life that you need a total cleansing of the Word of God to happen to you. There are people who are listening to me today online that you've suffered some of the worst kind of abuses. And today God wants to heal you. This morning when I got up, the Holy Spirit said, John, you got your message all prepared except one sentence. And I said, what is it, God? And he said, tell the people sitting in front of you, like I told you earlier, that I took that sexual abuse, I took that sin, I took that shame, I took that hurt that was put on you by somebody else, and I drank it myself in the Garden of Gethsemane so that you don't have to live under that anymore. Let them know I have set them free because I drank their cup for them. If you're here today and you want to be free from some of the things that happened to you in the past, just raise your hand now. I want to pray with you. God's moving in a special way here this morning. He wants to fix some things that were broken for a long time. Let him do it in your life today. Just raise your hand and I'm going to pray for you. Jesus, I pray this morning for people sitting here in this room. There's some things that are broken here that only you can heal. There's some things that have been taken out of joint here that only you can put back in place. There are some things that have been really, really broken that right now in the name of Jesus Christ, you are going to heal. I pray this morning, Lord, where shame and hurt and dismay and pain has controlled lives, that in the name of Jesus Christ, they'll be free today. Hallelujah. 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 You tasted it for us, God. We don't have to live under its dominion anymore. Set them free in Jesus' name. Let them know the freedom of the presence of your Holy Spirit in their lives, oh God, for the kingdom. Oh God, thank you. Thank you. Somebody suffering pain in their body this morning, and God wants to fix that thing that the doctor can't. In Jesus' name, I release you this morning. When the doctor has said to you, there's no more I can do, I release you in Jesus' name. Be fixed. Be healed. Be set free. Hallelujah. 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 Stand with me and raise your hands and say, Lord, fix me today. Fix me today. I've been broken. Jesus' name. Fix me. Fix my body. Fix my soul. Fix my spirit, oh God, in Jesus' name.
The chasm that lay between us, how high the mountain I could not climb. In desperation, I turned to heaven and spoke your name. The darkness, your loving kindness tore through the shadows of my soul. The work is finished, the end is written. Jesus Christ, my could imagine so great a mercy. What heart could fathom such boundless grace? The God of ages stepped down from glory to wear my sin and bear my shame. The cross has spoken, I am forgiven. The King of Kings calls me his own. Beautiful Savior, I'm yours forever. Jesus Christ, my praise the the promise, your buried body began to breathe. Out of the silence, the roaring lion declared your grave has no claim on me. Sing that again. Then came the morning that sealed the promise. Your buried body began to breathe. Out of the silence, the roaring lion declared the grave has no claim on me.
Christ is our living hope. He died on the cross for us, and all that suffering that he endured that John was talking about this morning, that song we sang this morning, The More I Seek You, that was led by the Spirit. Last night I couldn't get a certain song, and I said to Pam, I can't seem to get that song. She said, let's do The More I Seek You. And there couldn't have been a more fitting song that came before that sermon. And this one, last minute this morning, Pam, because I couldn't get another song. So it is so glorious how the Spirit just leads you where you need to be when you need to be there. Thank you, Lord, and he will follow you wherever you go. Thank you, Lord. So good, Lord.
Everywhere I go on this road, high and low, where I go with you. Where I go with you. There's a city that calls me by name. Oh, there's a city that calls me by name. This night. Where I go with